Hello and welcome to part 2 of the video series on how to design a CNC router. Thank you all for joining me. As you can see on my desktop or in Fusion 360, I already went ahead and modeled the base structure or the table for the CNC router, but I want to lead you through steps that I went through to get to this point. First, let me go back in the timeline. First of all, I obviously started with a blank assembly or blank design. Then I imported my first aluminum extrusion, grounded it, and then I imported all the other extrusions. Actually, I built it earlier, or I already had it built or designed in order to get all the measurements so it will work out. So here you can see this is the actual base structure of CNC, and it's a whole lot of aligning it. And I really don't know why Autodesk does this. Every time you hit align, you get to choose a face or a point on the object that you want to align, and then you choose, you go from to another point, and then you hit okay. This all is fine, but all the time when you click okay, this little window disappears, it closes out. Why can't they make it like in for example Inventor, where this always is open until you are done with aligning things or joining things together, and then you could just cancel out this window. This would make it a whole lot quicker to get to this point where you align everything. This really bothers me, and I don't know why they change it. So yeah, enough of that. Let's go further in the timeline. Then I modeled up those plates. Actually, I took measurements from the frame, from there to the backside, and it's 80 millimeter wide. This is because the profiles are also 80 millimeter wide. Then I inserted one plate and then copied it three times. Then I jointed them to the midpoint of this profile, or of those profiles. It's just a rigid joint. Then I imported or inserted one linear rail, and then also copied it three times. Same thing. This time I didn't jointed it to the midpoint of this plate. Actually, where did I joint it? Let me see. I jointed it from the first hole of the rail to the first hole of the aluminum plate. So yeah, I did this for all of the four rails. Then I took measurements for this plate. It's the distance from in between those two profiles. and it's obviously the height of the profiles. This is actually this plate. Right here goes the servo. It's adjustable because I want to make the drivetrain with timing belt. This is where the bearing block of the ball screw goes. And those are the mounting holes in order to accept two other plates that will bolt onto the profiles. So then I aligned this properly. I then copied it, just the same thing, aligned it. Then I inserted the servo motor and the bearing blocks, aligned them. Then here's the ball screw. I will later go over it on how I designed them, because as you can see, here is a thread, but it's not correctly modeled. It's actually just for looks. Yeah, then I aligned this one, or I joined this one to the bearing blocks. This is, here I inserted another bearing. This is for back end of the ball screw. And you can see there's on. Another one goes there. Then I modeled up this plate. Just bolts directly onto profile. Inserted, aligned. Then this here is the plate that will go into here. Inserted it, aligned it, copied it three times. Ball screw nut. Where did it go? Oh yeah. Back here, I jointed it to the ball screw itself. It's just a sliding joint. Same thing there. Then I had to rejoin those servos, because I had to tweak those plates, because I didn't account for adjusting the stepper motors in order to tension the timing belt. So I had to go back and tweak the plate, because this one actually just was a normal circle and it wasn't slotted. So I couldn't adjust the timing belt properly, or I really couldn't adjust it. So I had to go back and make a design change. Yes, obviously I hadn't to go back if I would model all those components in one assembly, but then this here wouldn't be as clean as it now is, because as you can see here, all those components are linked. Actually, it all goes back to here, where my aluminum extrusions are. I named them properly, and if I go into for example this one, then I can change the parameter of it, of the length, to maybe 500 millimeter. Then I have to click save, and then I have to go back and rename it so I have the right part. So then I would call it 500 millimeter. It's a bit of a tedious work, but it really rewards me with a clean, nice assembly where everything is linked. And if I have to change something in here, if I would model it all in one assembly, then I would actually lose the overview of where I made some tweaks, or where I had to change things. So I really like this way. Although it is a bit more time consuming, and you actually have to think and measure a lot more that way. But this is my way on designing things. And it actually works out for me pretty well. So let's go forward here. Here I had to change the joint because I had to turn this motor 90 degrees. Same thing on the other motor. Then the carriages came in, or I inserted them. Inserted it once, copied it 7 times, because on each rail will go 2 of those carriages. Then I had to turn them also 90 degrees. Then I just jointed them with a sliding joint. It's a little time consuming, but this is how the process is. Then I designed this plate. This plate is the ball screw nut. Ball screw nut mounting plate. This is this one. Also here I had to take a measurement for the placement of this hole to the top face. This actually is this distance. Goes from there to the midpoint of this circle, and it's 108.10 millimeters. So I modeled it up this way. It just went through here. Just modeled a basic rectangle, and distance from there to there is 108.10 millimeters. Yeah, extruded it, made a couple changes, made the holes, and done. So yeah, imported this one, copied it one time. Those plates are the side plates that will go on here. This is this plate. No, actually doesn't. This one is it. Also here, for those holes and those, no, only for those two holes. I took those measurements, just put them in here. Yeah, and then I copied those. Then I jointed them to those base plates. Then the base plate goes onto the ball screw nut. Same thing there. Then I made my table, my actual table. And for those holes, or for this whole pattern, I took the measurements from there to there, and from there to there. So I have this pattern, then from there to there. So I have this distance. So yeah, you kind of get the point. It's a whole lot of measuring in order to make it all work out. Yes, it would be easier if I would just draw a rectangle here in this assembly, line all those carriages up, and the base plates of those ball screw nuts. But I want to keep it clean. This is the whole point. So yeah. Then I assembled it to the carriages and to those base plates from the ball screw nuts. Here I had to tweak. There was something wrong with those ones here, those plates, because I actually had a conflict with one rigid group that I made earlier. I had to delete some rigid groups and then assemble them back together with some normal joints. This solved the whole problem. So yeah, same thing here. Sometimes if you have a problem with a rigid group or something else, it may cause some trouble in the whole assembly. So you actually have to dig way deeper than you might think. But if you get a hang of it, you will solve it pretty quickly. So yeah, this actually wraps the assembly of the base structure up. Yeah. This is how it will look. Actually, or I will hope that it will be pretty sturdy. This one here is a 20mm aluminum plate. Those ones here, those mounting plates are 15mm. And all the rest here is all 20mm aluminum. Those linear guides or linear rails are 35mm ones from Bosch. Yeah. This is how I would design this one. Now let us go to the ball screw just to have a look. Basically I draw a circle. This is the overall diameter of the ball screw. It's a 20mm circle. Then I extrude it to the given length. This one is 950mm. Then I create another sketch on the front end of the ball screw. I extrude this one to the given length. Another sketch on the front end. Extrude it back. Then I make another sketch on the back end of the ball screw. Extrude it. Then this also only is for looks. I make the thread where the lock nut goes on. And then I make this one. This actually is just a spiral. Let me see, edit feature. How do I explain it? The ball screw that I'm using has a 10mm pitch. Diameter is 20mm, and the overall height, which means from this point, from here, from this face to the end, to this face, is 877mm. This is because I have to subtract the machined ends from the overall length of the ball screw. So this is why I'm coming up with this number. And this number divided by 10, or divided through 10, gives me 87.7 revolutions, if this makes any sense. Section size is 5mm. This is the diameter of the spiral. So yeah, this gives me the thread. It's not modeled the correct way, I know. Because my ball screws that have 10mm pitch actually look a bit different, but this only is for looks, so it works out for me. Then I put on some chamfers here and there, and then this one is finished too. So yeah, this wraps it up. Next part will be the gantry and the gantry risers. And yeah, If we have the gantry completed and the gantry risers, we will put it on here, make a nice assembly of those two parts, and then I will go on to the X-axis carriage and the Z-axis. So I think I will be done in about 3 or 4 parts, so won't take too long to finish this design process. So yeah, if you like this video, please give me a thumbs up. Also, you can go to my Instagram profile and our Facebook page. Just leave a like and just DM us if you have any questions. Yeah, just have a great time watching our videos if they aren't too boring and if my English isn't too bad. So yeah, thanks for watching, guys, and have a nice day.